happened to me around this time of year, Easter time. So my mommy took me and my brother to the beach to go Easter egg hunting. But we got to the beach late for Easter egg hunting. So if you look up there should be a picture of a whole bunch of kids and a whole bunch of eggs. But when we got there were no eggs because we got there late. So we were digging in the sand looking for eggs, and we only found like three. And there were some kids that came there were some kids that came later than me and my brother. And even though I had a little bit of eggs, I decided to share my eggs with the kids that had no eggs at all. And they wouldn't find eggs because all the eggs were taken. So I gave all my eggs away, and my mommy was like, "What are you doing? Don't do that. Keep the eggs." But I didn't keep the eggs. I gave them away. So when we were done picking eggs, I opened one of my brother's eggs because I didn't have any. So I opened up one of my brother's eggs, and there was a coupon. I was so surprised. I thought there would be like a toy or a candy or something else inside. And turns out the coupon was for a fair near the beach that we were at, and for the rides and games at the fair. And I was like, oh no, I should have kept those eggs. Oh man, mommy forgot her wallet in the car, and the car is parked far away, and all that. But I didn't feel that bad because I got to share my Easter eggs, and that made me feel happy. There's a story in the Bible that's similar to this, where there was a boy and he had 5 loaves of bread and 2 fish, and he shared it with Jesus, and Jesus fed 5,000 people with that boy's food. Just because of that one boy, a whole bunch of people got food. Let us pray. Dear Jesus, please help us to share and have a good Sabbath, and the rest of the Sabbath goes great. Amen.
Amen.
Will the deacons please come forward to
Superman, the toys, and Aquaman.
Please pray with us as we ask God to bless our tithes and offerings. Father, everything we have comes from you. There is nothing we can do without you. We thank you for the money you have provided for us. We want to return some of our money to you as tithes to say thank you and offerings to say we love you. Please bless this money so that your work can be done on this earth and more people can learn of your love and care. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Thank you.
nature to read each other's faces. We feel when we see each other's faces, we can see character and mood. When I look at the Alexander Hamilton portrait by John Trumbull, I see an important man with an expression of hope for America and happiness. When I look at the Anna Hart portrait, I see a man who has been very troubled, even dangerous. I think about them differently, by their expressions and history. Before we continue, let's have a word of prayer. Dear God, thank you for this opportunity to share your message. Please let the Holy Spirit be with us and lead us into your truth. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Let me set the scene for you. In today's scripture reading, the children of Israel are gathered at Mount Sinai to receive the Ten Commandments. Moses has been on Mount Sinai talking with God for 40 days and 40 nights. And as his relationship with God grows, he has the overwhelming desire to see God's face. But in Exodus 33:20, God says, "You cannot see my face, for no one may see me and live." But God wants to reveal himself to Moses, so he says, "I will cause all my goodness to pass in front of you. Now proclaim my name, the Lord, in your presence. I will have mercy on whom I have mercy, and I will have compassion on whom I will have compassion." God says, if you saw a portion of me, you would see mercy and compassion. When God described himself to Moses, of all the things he could have mentioned, such as knowledge, power, and strength, he focuses on his mercy and compassion. In 2 Corinthians 1:3-7, Paul says, God is the father of compassion. So all forms of compassion come from God, who is the master of compassion. What is compassion? Compassion comes from Latin, literally meaning co-suffering. In simple words, when someone else suffers, you suffer. In modern usage, an act of compassion is defined by its helpfulness. It differs from sympathy, because compassion leads to action. When God said he was compassion, he didn't just have sympathy for our pain and suffering. He was staying ready to help us, because God is a God of action. There are many stories in the Bible that show compassion, including the story of Moses, when the prince of Egypt took pity on him as a baby, and later as a prince, when Moses saw his people suffering. He was moved to free them, but it was only when his efforts were united with God's that he was able to accomplish his goal. Joseph, who showed compassion to his brothers, even when they had sold him to slavery, and when King David invites him to the bishop, Jonathan's son, who shows him compassion by giving him Saul's land. The Bible is the history of humans getting into trouble and God showing compassion, both directly and through his chosen agent. In John 14:9, Jesus said, "Have I been so long a time with you, and yet hast thou not known me, Philip? He that hath seen me hath seen the Father. And how sayest thou then, show us the Father?" When we see Jesus, we see God. When we see Jesus' life, we see God's compassion in action. Compassion is at the core of the plan of salvation. God didn't just have sympathy, but he took action and sent Jesus to die for our sins. In Luke 7:11-17, says, "As he drew near to the gate of the town, behold, a man who had died was being carried out, the only son of his mother, and she was a widow. And a considerable crowd from the town was with her. When the Lord saw her, he had compassion on her, and said to her, 'Do not weep.' Then he came up and touched the bier, and the bearer stood still. He said, 'Young man, I say to you, arise.' And the dead man sat up and began to speak. And Jesus gave him to his mother. Fear seized them all, and they glorified God's name. A great prophet has arisen among us, and God has visited his people." Jesus was moved by the woman's sorrow and took action and raised her son from the dead. In John 6:5-15, it says, "When Jesus looked up and saw a great crowd coming toward him, he said to Philip, 'Where should we buy bread for these people to eat?' He asked us only to test him, for he already had in mind what he was going to do. Philip answered him, 'It would take more than half a year's wages to buy enough bread for each one to have a bite.' Another of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, spoke up. 'Here is a boy with 5 small barley loaves and 2 small fish. But how far will they go among so many?' Jesus said, 'Have the people sit down.' There was plenty of grass in that place, and they sat down. About 5,000 men were there. Jesus then took the loaves, gave thanks, and distributed to those who were seated as much as they wanted. He did the same with the fish. When they all had enough to eat, he said to his disciples, 'Gather the pieces that are left over. Let nothing be wasted.' So they gathered them and filled 12 baskets with the pieces of the 5 barley loaves left over by those who ate. Jesus had compassion for the hungry people and fed them with the little boy's lunch. Then we come to the pinnacle of Jesus' ministry on earth.
In Luke 23, 32, verses 34, it says, "There were also two other criminals led with him to be put to death. And when they had come to the place called Calvary, there they crucified him, and the criminals, one on the right hand and the other on the left. Then Jesus said, 'Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they do.'" When Jesus was nailed to the cross, it was the most stressful and painful time a human could experience, but Jesus was worried about the soldiers and did the only thing he could for them. He prayed for them. When I consider this heartbreaking scene, it is undeniable Jesus was defined by his compassion. Compassion is important because it is one of God's defining characteristics, and we want to be like him. A compassionate Christian is an active Christian. Without compassion, Christianity is empty. So what can we do to make certain our Christianity is compassionate? We live in a troubled world. It is easy to feel our efforts are insignificant, thereby excuse our lack of compassion. As the story of the boy with the loaves of fish shows, even the smallest act of compassion, God make it. By himself, the little boy could have solved the problem, but he gave what he had, and God did the rest. Sometimes people who need compassion are the people who don't deserve it. We have to remember that all of God's compassion has been given to us, even if though we don't deserve it. To follow God's example, we want to help people who don't deserve it and need God's insight on how to do this. Finally, we need to remember to pray for God's help, to recognize opportunities to share his compassion, and ask for his blessings on our efforts. The disciples saw the little boy's loaves and fishes, and thought it was inadequate, but Jesus saw an opportunity. To make our compassion effective, we need God's insight. As Christians, our goal is to develop a clear portrait of God and share that with others. One of God's most important characteristics is his compassion. In order to share God with others, we need to share his compassion. When we share God's compassion with others, we help them see God more clearly. When they see God more clearly, they will understand his goodness and be drawn to love him. For the closing of the sermon, let's have another word of prayer. Dear God, I thank you that you are a compassionate God, ready to get involved in our lives. Even the smallest problem does not escape your attention. Today, the world needs to see who we are to understand the beauty of your character more than ever. So I ask that you make me a nail upon the wall, fast and secure in its place, that from this thing so common and so small, hang a bright picture of that face. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
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 Thank you. Yeah.